Good morning, everyone. Good morning. Welcome to worship here at Harrisburg United Methodist Church. We are so glad that you are part of our Advent celebration this morning, as it is the second week of Advent as we prepare for the coming of the Christ child. It is a day of and a time of preparation, of self-examination, and of worship together. We have a full menu this morning, including a baptism right in the middle of Advent, which is fantastic, celebrating new life and commitment of parents to raise their child into a Christian home. So we are excited about that this morning. My name is Richard Smith. I am the pastor of families and students here at Harrisburg, and warmly welcome all of you. If you're visiting with us this morning, we especially welcome you and glad that you are here with us. We would love to know a little bit more about you, so if you felt free, we would love to get some information from you. So in the pew in front of you is a little green card that you can fill out with some information and drop that in the offering plate, and that way we can have a little an email or something so that we can make some contact. We would love to know who you are and ways that we can help be a church to you, possibly, if you're in our community. Also, if you're with us online, we warmly welcome you, and again, we ask that to let us know you're present by liking the feed or putting a prayer request in the feed would be great, and our prayer team will get to those on this afternoon and Monday. Also, for you here with us, there is prayer requests on that green card, so feel free if there's something that you want prayed for. We will put that on our list this week, and we will be praying for it. We know how overwhelming the holiday season can be. Just yesterday, my wife ventured out towards the mall area. And it was not a pleasant experience. She wasn't going to the mall, just had to go to places near the mall. And people were losing their minds, okay? So as we gather together for worship, I want us to gather our minds and our presence together. And we'll talk more about that in just a little bit. First of all, I have several announcements. Okay, this is the most important of all my announcements. For the next 3 weeks, all right, everybody put three fingers. For the next 3 weeks, we will have one worship service, and it will be at 10 o'clock, okay? All right, 3 weeks, one worship service at 10 o'clock, okay? So please, if you show up at 9, you're a little early. If you show up at this time at 11, we'll pray for you, okay? Because you just missed it. So please remember that and spread the word. Somebody always misses the announcement. So the next thing I'll have to do is make you stand up and jump up and down so you will remember. So I don't want to do that. Secondly, for our Christmas Eve service, we have the 10 o'clock service on Christmas Eve. We also have three services that night. We have a children's service at 5 o'clock, and we have a candlelight and communion service at 7 and 11. We are short ushers at the 7 o'clock, so if you would like to usher at the 7 and help us out, please let Sarah Barclay know or call the church office, and we will make her a happy camper, okay? She's got a lot of folks to organize for that day. It's a lot of services on Christmas Eve. All right, next Sunday is our Christmas musical cantata. You will hear music all Sunday morning by the choir, by the praise band, by the children. It's going to be a fantastic day. So be here at 10 o'clock. Come early, get your seat early, because there'll be lots of families here. We would love for you to come and be a part of that. Also, if you hadn't had enough worship yet, on Thursday night, the 21st, is our Blue Christmas. Our Blue Christmas service is geared for those folks who may be struggling with burdens during Christmas time and during the holiday season. Holiday season isn't always joyous for a lot of people. A lot of times folks have hurts or pain or grief that kind of prevents us from celebrating the way everybody else seems to be wanting to celebrate. And this is a service of reflection. It'll be a quiet time where you can come and process and try to leave those burdens on the altar. For a lot of us, there's always a parent or a grandparent or someone who has passed at this time of year and makes the whole Christmas dynamic a little different. So we invite you to come to be a part of that on the 21st. One last announcement. I know it's a lot. Today, 3 o'clock to 5 p.m., there is a big, huge children's family event in the Fellowship Hall. If you have a child of any age, please come and be a part of our event. There's lots of stations, lots of work has gone into that, and it is going to be a fun, fun day. So come and be a part. And if you're a child at heart, we would welcome you if you guys want to come and see some fun things happening. So you're all welcome to come and join us for our family Christmas party, 3 to 5 today here at the church. That's a lot. I invite you to take that deep breath and let it out. And I want you to leave whatever is bugging you, whatever's on your mind, I want you to leave it at the foot of the altar that's in your mind so that you can be ready to hear what God is going to tell you today. I invite you to expect God to speak to you, because that's when we are most receptive to hear what he's trying to say to us. So I invite you to let God in and put the world on hold for the next hour. I also invite you during our hymns to please come up here and pray on our prayer shawl. It is for Christina, who had emergency surgery Wednesday night, who is the daughter of Sue and Ward Heffron. So during the hymns, feel free, be really careful. This thing will be on fire, so please be careful as you come up, but we would love for you to pray prayers for Christina on the prayer shawl. And here comes the rain. I invite you to please stand for our first hymn this morning. O come, come thou traveler unknown.
Thank you.
I invite you to be seated.
In the days when God's people longed for peace, Isaiah declared, "Comfort, O comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and cry to her that she has served her term and that her penalty is paid, that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins."
We who gather here today also seek comfort and peace, yet we are unsatisfied with ideas of peace that tells us to keep quiet and go with the flow. We long for real peace, true peace, just peace.
We wait as people who yearn for peace that bears the fruit of the community, equity, and flourishing for all.
We light these candles as a sign of God's shocking hope and just peace. May they be beacons calling us to repent and live the good news of Jesus Christ as we wait and watch and labor for the day when all people can gather together to worship and glorify God. Amen.
Amen. Thank you guys so much. As we come to our time of prayer this morning, I want us to think about other people's burdens. You don't know what's going on in someone else's life. You might know about your spouse or someone close to you, but the angry person in the middle of the road blocking four lanes of traffic yesterday morning because they didn't want to wait on the red light and caused everybody lots of anger and consternation in the meantime with their behavior being questionable also. So instead of getting angry at people this season, instead of getting frustrated with others as we go about our shopping or whatever it is we do out in public, maybe we would follow Wesley and be bearers of grace, because we don't know what's going on. We don't know what crisis someone might be in the middle of. And so we, as Christ's people, we're called to a different way of living and of looking at things. So maybe this holiday we can bring about the joy of Christ by not giving in to the anger, but maybe giving in to the grace and being bearers of hope in a world, as we watch, desperately needs that, the hope and the love that Christ brings. So will you join me in prayer this morning? Gracious Lord, we thank you so much for the coming of the Christ child, for this time of preparation as we are on that journey to Bethlehem. We see the struggles of Mary and Joseph, of being unwed and she's pregnant with child, and then Joseph being called out by an angel saying, "You need to marry her no matter what, because that's God's child." And we know that they faced difficulties, but everyone did not know what was going on and how God was going to reveal his plan to the world. The same thing for us today. We don't know what's going on in each other's minds and hearts. We do know that there is lots of stress, lots of grief, of love. There's so much anger and people feeling that they're not worth very much. So God, help us to understand that when we look at someone who's causing us pain and anger and not behaving the way that we think that they should. Help us to live and to lean into the life of love and of joy that you bring for us. Help us to remember that there might be a little bit more going on in that person's life. Lord, I lift up those so many of us in this congregation who are grieving or who are going through difficult times. We have family members and spouses who are struggling with disease that we just can't seem to get beyond. Some of us have lost loved ones in recent days. And Lord, this morning I lift up Tim Martin and his loss of his wife of 47 years this week, Darlene. Pray special blessings upon them and all so many others who are dealing with the grief of spouses not being around at the most joyous of times. When families get together and there's that empty seat at the table, it all brings us back to a pain and to a time of grief. But Lord, help us not to stay there. Help us to understand that you have won the victory, that that person is still a part of our lives just as you are, Lord. You fill our lives with hope and with joy in your presence. May we be beings and bearers of that light. May we be full of your presence, God, as we interact and love and are with one another. Make us sensitive to those around us, that we would lift them up, that we would be your hands and feet, and also people who would spread your hope and joy around to the world around us. And God, we thank you so much for your love, because it is that love that is the cornerstone of unifying us, of making us one people. So this morning, as we pray that prayer that Jesus taught us in the New Testament together, may it be something that binds us in the midst of all that we face. So God, hear our prayer this morning. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Good morning. It is a joy and a privilege this morning to be allowed to baptize a child during this Advent season. I'm privileged because since appointment here at Harrisburg, this is my fourth baptism. There was Ivy, there was Bennett, there was Riley, and now we have Luca this morning. And I say that with my chest poked out because I remember my first year in ministry 24 years ago. And the guys used to tease me, because my first year I had 12 eulogies to do. And they said, boy, you don't supposed to kill them, you're supposed to bring them in. But now I have bragging rights. And I don't think none of them are near four for the year. So I'm in good company. But I want Tony and Anthony and also Bonnie Fairchild and all those sponsors with you today to please come to the altar this morning for this moment of grace that God extends to us. You will all just assemble right here. Luca has his white bow tie on today. Yeah, blue the other day. Brothers and sisters in Christ, through the sacrament of baptism, we are initiated into Christ's holy church. We are incorporated into God's mighty acts of salvation and given new birth through water and the Spirit. And all this is God's gift, offered to us without a price. On behalf of the whole church, I ask you, the family here, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin? Please answer by saying, I do.
I do.
Do you accept the freedom and power that God gives you to resist evil, injustice, oppression, in whatever forms they present themselves? Please answer by saying, I do. Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior? Put your whole trust in his grace, and promise to serve him as your Lord in union with the church, which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and races? Please answer by saying, I do. Will you nurture Luca in Christ's holy church, that by your teachings and example, he may be guided to accept God's grace for himself, to profess his faith openly, and lead a Christian life? Everyone. Do you, as a Christ body, the church, reaffirm both your rejection of sin and your commitment to Christ?
We do.
We will surround Luca with a community of love and forgiveness, that he may grow in his trust of God and be found faithful in his service to others. We will pray for him that he might be a true disciple who walks in the way that leads to life. Let us join together in professing the Christian faith as contained in the scriptures of the Old and New Testaments. Do you believe in God the Father?
I believe in God the Father Almighty.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ?
I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord.
Do you believe in the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Eternal Father, when nothing exists but chaos, you swept across the dark waters and brought forth light. In the days of Noah, you saved those on the ark through water. And after the flood, you set in the clouds a rainbow. When you saw your people as slaves in Egypt, you led them to freedom through the sea. Their children you brought through the Jordan to the land which you promised.
Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Tell of God's mercy he shed.
In the fullness of time, you sent Jesus nurtured in the water of a womb. He was baptized by John and anointed by your Spirit. He called his disciples to share in the baptism of his death and resurrection and to make disciples of all nations.
Declare his works to the nations, his glory among all people.
Gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit to bless this gift of water and those who receive it, to wash away their sin and clothe them in righteousness throughout the life that dying and being raised with Christ, they may share in his final victory.
All praise to you, eternal Father, through your Son, Jesus Christ, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns forever. Amen.
Now it is our joy to welcome our new brother in Christ.
Baptism, you are incorporated by the Holy Spirit into God's new creation and made to share in Christ's royal priesthood. We are all one in Christ Jesus. With joy and thanksgiving, we welcome you as a member of the family of Christ.
Members of the household of God, I commend Luca to your love and care. Do all in your power to increase his faith, confirm his hope, and perfect him in love.
We give thanks for all that God has already given you, and we welcome you in Christian love, as members together in the body of Christ and in this congregation of the United Methodist Church. We renew our covenant faithfully to participate in the ministries of the church. By our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness, that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ.
The God of all grace, who has called us to extend glory in Christ, establish you and strengthen you by the power of the Holy Spirit, that you may live in grace and peace. What is this child's given name? Luca. Wilkes, their child. Ooh, he's here too. Luca, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and the blessed Holy Spirit. Luca, let me introduce you to your new church family. And Jesus loves the little children, but they are responsible for bringing you up in the way of Christ. I want you to take a good look at the choir, at the congregation here. And I'm not going to sing, but Jesus loves the little children, all the children of the world, red and yellow, black and white. They are special in the sight. Jesus loved the little children of the world. And these in the amen corner over here, they have responsibility. So we're just glad to have you here this morning. In this basket is a certificate, baptism certificate, which is a legal document to use for Luca's witness here today. Also, you have a book and a letter personally from me. And this candle is to remember his baptism and to light it on that day each year for the choice you made for his life. Like that, Luca? Blessings and peace to each and every one of you. Wait a minute. That goes in. Thank you.
ushers come forward, would you pray with me? Gracious Lord, we thank you so much for the ability to give, Lord, for the many, many blessings you poured out upon us as a church and as a body. We pray that we would be honest and that we would be diligent stewards of what is giving, that we would give back to our communities through it. So take this generous offering that we're about to receive and bless it with your hand, Lord, that we would be your people recognized in this place by your love that flows through all of us. In Jesus' name, amen. Standing for our next song, I invite our children ages 3 through 1st grade to go with Miss Michelle to Children's Church, and I invite you to sing heartily in our next song.
Thank you. God. Grace and peace to each and every one of you from God the Father through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who's given us another day's journey during this Advent season. Last week we talked about stay awake. And today, as we look at the epistle coming from 2 Peter, the third chapter, it talks about being prepared. And those who are able to stand, will you please stand as we read the scripture coming from 2 Peter chapter 3, verses 8 through 15. But do not ignore this one fact, beloved, that with the Lord one day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years are like one day. And the Lord is not slow about his promise, as some think of slowness, but is patient with you, not wanting any to perish, but all to come to repentance. But the day of the Lord will come like a thief, and then the heavens will pass away with a loud noise, and the elements will be dissolved with fire, and the earth and everything that is done on it will be disclosed. Since all these things are to be dissolved in this way, what sort of people ought you to be in leading lives of holiness and godliness, waiting for and hastening the coming of the day of the God, because of which the heavens will be set ablaze and dissolved, and the elements will melt with fire? But in accordance with this promise, we wait for new heavens and a new earth where righteousness is at home. Therefore, beloved, while you are waiting for these things, strive to be found by him at peace, without spot or blemish. And regard the patience of our Lord as salvation. So also our beloved brother Paul wrote to you according to the wisdom given to him. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated. Will you pray with me, please? Consecrate me now for thy service, Lord. Yes, by your power of grace divine, may my soul look up with a steadfast hope and always allow Frederick's will to be lost in thine. Now, Lord, the word is yours. The spirit is yours. And we are yours. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Be prepared. The early service did not share these stats with them, but I ran across some stats coming by USA Today. In the year 2000, they asked, what are some of the things that people most fear? 36% said not being able to pay medical bills. 31% caring for their elderly parents. 22% said no inheritance to pass on to their children. And 20% that the stock market will crash. Now, this is almost 25 years ago now. And those fears are still in the minds and hearts of our people. But how often do you think to be prepared when the Lord, those who truly believe that he will return again? I use that subject, be prepared, and I was a Boy Scout like probably some of you. The motto was be prepared. And the founder of the Boy Scouts, Robert Baden Powell, was at a meeting, and he was talking about the motto, be prepared. And he had an audience in front of him. And somebody asked the question, be prepared for what? So he had to revise and rethink what he was doing when he wrote the book about scouting in 1907. He said, being prepared means you are always ready to take up the readiness in mind, body, and your duty. And I looked at that as a born-again believer, as we truly believe in this Christ, that we will come again. What are we doing to prepare? We do the things that we should do by going to church, reading our Bibles and stuff, but are we prepared for Christ's coming? And as I said, this is a tough text, but I do believe Peter has a nugget in this sermon. But I asked a question this morning, and I asked myself, when the last time I really reflected on the patience that God has for me? That's a question for all of us. How much patience will God have for us? Since we don't know the day or the hour, and he's saying to be returned, he's telling us to be prepared, but I do believe that the ethos of this text is right in verse 14. And it says, therefore, beloved, while you are waiting for these things, waiting don't mean you're not doing anything. Strive to be found by him, God, at peace with him, and without spot or blemish, and regard the patience of our Lord as to salvation. But it's frustrating when we read through the Holy Writ of all the patience that God had with his children through the Bible. We look at even the creation story with Adam and Eve when they decided to get in front of God. And of course, the fall came. And it was years later, decades later, centuries later, that God decided to send one of his best weapons, which was in Jesus. I recall a story over there in Genesis chapter 4, where even when Cain killed Abel, God put a mark on Cain, and he went into a place, a land of Nod. We don't know where Nod is. But for God to have that much patience, when he didn't bring his best offering, then he killed his brother, and God was able to put a mark on him that nobody touches soul. That's how much God loves us. That's why he go to so much extreme to avail himself to us. But how much patience have you thought about it that he gives each one of us when we go off the beaten path? God is preparing us for his return. Did he send his only begotten son, Jesus? The best weapon could possibly be. But before he did that, he had patience enough to send his prophets one at a time. And I look at, I don't know how in the world he gave the patience to the Israelites coming out of bondage. Here Jesus had to move them out of bondage to go into the promised land, 40 years in the desert, didn't know what they was eating. He still fed them, clothed them, and took care of them, and yet still, they rebel. It's something about human nature that we don't think about how much patience God has with us. Even to the point before they went into the promised land, he gave them all the material they needed in order to keep going on. They were to carry the Ark of the Covenant, that the presence of God is with them. And in that Ark of the Covenant were three things for them to be reminded of. One was that manna that he fed them when they was hungry and didn't have nothing to eat. He's telling them, I will always provide for you. There was the Ten Commandments of the law that we abide by. Anything outside of that is a violation. And the third thing in the Ark of the Covenant was Aaron's budded cross that represent leadership, provision, protection, leadership. And yet he still has patience with us. When we go astray, oh, well, I go astray. Y'all don't go astray. I do. He has patience to bring us back to the fold. How can you put up with Israel and all the opportunities that he gave them to repent and to come back to him? But we also must look at the patience of Jesus. 12 ordinary men, not the very top of the crust, Some of them were arrogant. One even said, we lost, left everything we had just to follow you. But here they are following him. He didn't look for a special breed. He knew they all would fall short. He knew, and some of them didn't even get it till after the resurrection. So once again, how much patience that God gives you and I. And yet we go through this fallen world making other things a priority. Not this church, I'm talking about those other churches who's listening. Listening for what God has for us. And I'm coming around to us because we're on this side of the cross. God does not demand us to instantly come to maturity. But he wants us still to be prepared, growing in his ways. It's not a sprint. It's a marathon. When we are growing in him and trusting him and knowing that he is our all in all. And how much patience he has with us. Because he knows we need him. He don't need us. He doesn't require us to get it quickly. Because he knows that we get to the world of all those worldly things we have that make us think who we are. But if those things were to go today, how will you stand before holy and righteous God who have patience for you to come back again? And he doesn't teach a lesson just once. I don't know about you, but I'm hard-headed at times. You got to give me the lesson over and over and over again. And a lot of them, I fail. My mentor and former pastor told me, say, when we give our life to Christ, and he's so right, we get the test first. Will you follow me or not? Then you get the lessons. And those lessons are every day that we have to walk on this earth, we're getting lessons every day. Somebody get that next week. Lessons to learn. But does it draw us closer to him to prepare for his coming again? Why does God have so much patience, as Peter is sharing with us this morning? Why does God tolerate us going the opposite direction to bring us back to the fold? Each time he designs a tool, don't miss this, for our transformation. He's transforming us every day as we live on this earth and grow and learn more about him. It's a transformation. He's designed for each and every one of us. And he used his tool. Story was told, y'all look like y'all need a story about now. The devil was having a yard sale. And he had all these tools set on the side. But he had a sign on one of the tools that looked very worn. This is not for sale. And so when people come up and they're interested in the tool that he has to sign on, he said, no, that's not for sale. That's my greatest tool against God's people. It's called encouragement. If I could take the encouragement out of them, then I could do what I want with them. And how many times often did we go with discouragement and frustrated over the things that we cannot have or the things that we wrestle hard for and then they go through our hands? When we have a good servant God who's waiting there to build us with provisions. So it's a transformative thing. He works the same over and over and over again. I'm sorry, none of us have graduated from God's school. I hate to bust somebody's bubble this morning, but you've got some more learning to do. And he's constantly working through us and in us. So what am I saying? God's care is not to be detached from his patience. If we was on our own, it'd be a basket case. He stays attached to us, guiding us, giving us what we need, but Where do we look for that? In our selfish behavior. Henry Nouwen said it very well. He said, quote, "Waiting is a period of learning. The longer we wait, the more we hear about him for whom we are waiting on." You know, we don't like to wait. We got that done in last week. We don't like to wait. We want instant things. We want to be gratified. We want instant mashed potatoes, instant grits, instant things, instant. And you find out it's not even worth, I don't know about you, but instant, no, that don't wash. But we want that instant gratification. And sometimes God needs us to wait a little longer. Come on, parents, you know that's with your children. Sometimes some things you want to give them, but you can't give it to them right now because they won't appreciate it. They got to be ready to receive what you're giving to them. And God does us the same way. Lesson after lesson. Until we get it right. Then he say, okay, now they're ready. It's a process. In times of waiting on God. But we know that he has patience with us. And we don't want him to run out of patience. Even all of us can identify with some of the things that we have accomplished in this world. But some of the things we have don't bring us peace. If you don't have peace with Christ, none of these other things are going to bring you peace. We have Christians trying to walk this journey of being a believer. But they must understand, they must continue to grow and serve regardless of what things look like. Continue to walk in his way that he called you for. Husband and wives at times are trying to stay faithful to each other. Those words just marinate till death do us part. When I used to marry a couple, I would take their vows and put it on in parchment paper and roll it in a scroll-like thing and give it to them as a gift from me. And they said, "Why do you give us this?" I said, "Well, when you get mad at each other, you go in there, you pull it out, and you both read what your covenant is. And they put a different perspective on things. Till death do us part." That's tough. If we follow a God who loves us despite who we are and has the patience for us, who wouldn't want to serve a God like that? Think about our young people who are trying to be Christ-like, but the peer pressure from their friends. When sometime I had to sort of break it down because I didn't want to get too, we got children in here, young girls, to wait on that special one. I don't need to go no further. But the peer pressure of this world, but if they stay with Christ, he's patient with them. It will happen. The peer pressure of this world. I have a few colleagues that we get together so often and pray for each other, lift each other up. And the saddest thing on my heart is when I find a man or woman of God have lost their passion for ministry. It's a hurting thing because when God called you to something to preach in season and out of season and preach Christ and being crucified, why can't you have that passion? What happened to that passion when you started out? And God is being patient with you. Do we get it right all the time? No. But where did you lose that passion for ministry that God called you to? And you know he had to have called you. And you're in this call until your last breath is taken away. And when you've done all that you can do, you say, "I'm just an unworthy servant doing what I'm supposed to do." So we lift those brothers and sisters up in prayer. They're not fed up with the church. It's the demands of ministry. For whom God calls, he equips, and he gives them what they stand in need of. And also their church members who are trying to do their best to follow Christ. In church, sometimes we have imperfect people all coming together. They're trying to weather the conflicts and remain that joy and love and faithfulness that God called them to as a member of his body. And too often, they get a bad report because they leave the church. And it's sad because I'm learning from a little boy. My mom said, if you can't say nothing good about somebody, don't say nothing at all. That's tight, but it's right. So we thank God today for his patience. But we must stay prepared because he may come today. And in this Advent season, on the reflections of those devotionals in that star book, please read those. They're very encouraging, self-reflecting. Thank God every day for his patience, his willingness to wait, that allow his powerful grace to finish transforming us into who he called us to be. Now, y'all pretty good because I had to fight the rain the first morning service. I was waiting for the first nod to go down. But y'all did good. People, I'm saying, we want to become more like him. Willing to give time for his mercy and do the work we were called to. Willing to give time to be prepared. And my brothers and sisters and my friends, that is peace with God. If you have peace with God, we don't have a snowball chance of nobody taking that peace away. In the name of the Father, name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit, let the church say, amen. Be prepared. And as we close our last song here, Hark the Herald Angels Sing. Glory to the newborn king. May we stand and lift up just.
Thank you.
gracious and holy God, we thank you for this mountain of privilege. How excellent is thy name in all the earth as we experience this Advent season. To stay awake and be prepared for your coming back again. And we all pray, oh God, that through your grace, that we won't take your patience for granted. Realizing, God, that you are the author and the finisher of our faith. And it's because of you that we live, we move, and have our being. Now may the love of God, the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit, rest, rule, and abide in each and every one of us as we part from this place, but never from your presence. In the matchless name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.